Oh, hey guys. Let's learn about layers and filters in Photoshop. Okay, so I had a video before this one. I'm assuming you've watched it or you know what's in it. I'm doing a series that prepares you for an online class, link in the description. So let's dive right in. Photoshop has layers, and a lot of the power of Photoshop is in the layers system. I'm just gonna cover the basics in this video, and then we're gonna go more advanced in future videos. So what we've got here is we've got a setup with a folder and then a bunch of these layers, and you see that they've got these effects on them. Some of the layers have effects. I can't select the effects here. That's like for a future video, but just keep in mind that that's what those are. And then I can click these eyeballs next to each layer to hide or show them. And it's very specific about where you clicked in order to do that. If I want, I can double click on a layer. I can rename it. I can click and drag a layer to reorder it if I want it to sort behind other layers. I can minimize the folder to keep things nice and tidy if you have a ton of layers. You can maximize it here. I can change the opacity of a layer to make it faded out. And so on and so forth. There's all kinds of fun stuff. If I hold Control, I can select multiple layers. If I keep holding it, I can deselect. And then if I use the Move tool, we learned about the Move or the Tools panel in the last video. If I use the Move tool, I can come over here and I can click and move the different layers. Now there's a gotcha here, and I'll show you that in a second. Let's say if I deselect the glow and then I click the Move tool, it's not working, right? It's actually just selecting the glow. Why is that? Well, the glow, as you can see, is like pretty transparent, but it's also like pretty big and solid. And because I have auto select turned on up here, with my Move tool settings, it's selecting whatever I click on. So here I clicked on the background and it's now moving that around. So if you deselect, let me undo so that I'm back on the... Okay, so apparently, this is another gotcha. Hitting undo does not put you back to what you had selected on your layers. It undoes everything else that you've done, but one thing it does not undo is choose this layer. Like if I see I'm like clicking and then hitting undo, it's not taking me back. Anyway, that's, I digress. So if I reselect all these layers, because I can't undo back to where it was, and that glow is in my way still, but if I turn off auto select, I can actually click anywhere and it'll like move whatever I want. Another fun option in the Move tool up here is the Show Transform controls. If I toggle that on, it gives me this bounding box and I can rotate like so, I can scale it like so. If I hold Shift, it'll just scale it on the one axis I'm doing. If I hold Alt and Shift, it'll do it from the center instead of the opposing line. If I just hold Alt, it'll do it uniformly from the center. Fun fact, hitting undo only gets me back one step. I can't undo all the way until I hit enter, and then I can undo the whole transform as one option. That's because here on the history, it just does free transform as a thing. One thing, not like rotate it a bit, then scale it a bit, and then you get the idea. So, some fun things with the undo functionality and transform. All right, so I'm going to turn off the transform controls. Honestly, guys, I use auto select and free transform. Sometimes, yes, sometimes not. Just depends on what I'm doing. I find them useful from time to time. All right, so we've learned about layers and how to click them and resort them and select them and move them. Useful stuff, useful stuff. Let's make sure I got everything we need. Oh, of course, with this selected, we want to also know that you can do edit transform, and then you can do all these different things like rotate, etc. You can do the free transform, which is what we just had selected by the transform controls. You can look into those other things later. You get the idea of like transforming, scaling, and all that. Pretty standard stuff. Okay, so we learned a little bit about the lasso tool. Let's say you select this. We learned in the last video how to use the lasso tool. And say you want to delete it. Well, if you're not on the right layer, hitting delete actually does nothing, right? So you got to make sure that you're on the right layer. And to do that, I just like to hide and show to find the layer that I'm after. Nope, nope, nope. It wasn't any of those. It was, oh, come on. There it is. Highlights, touch-ups. So if I'm on the right layer and I hit delete, then it'll delete whatever it was on that layer that you're after. Now let's say that I selected it, but I wanted just a little bit more selection or a little bit less. You can go to select. You can go to modify. And then you can say contract or expand. And it does about what you would expect. Contract by 6 pixels. So you're gonna shrink that selection in. It's pretty handy if you want to be very precise with like what you're selecting and how you're doing that. That's one thing that Shevlin uses in one of the videos as he's painting. Cool. So now for the fun part. We're gonna move on to filters. All right. So with your layers properly selected, I'm just gonna hit Control D for deselect. You can come in here and you can start adding some filters on these things. Let's see here. Let's hide all of these. And then also hiding the effects is really useful. What do I want to do? Hotspots. Hide that. Okay, so here's like some like streaky hotspots that he's got, right? And I want to put a filter on there that makes it feel nice and energetic and like it's moving really fast. Well, I know what moves fast. It's things that are blurred. So I go to filter, blur, and then blur you'd think would be the most commonly used one. Actually, for some reason, everyone I know uses Gaussian blur. I use Gaussian blur just because it's what I was taught to do. I don't know why. I just don't use blur. Anyway, I'm going to like really blur that out, and you can see pretty quickly that it doesn't really make it feel very energetic. It's unfortunate. Not what we want. So cancel that. Instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do blur radial blur because I want it to radiate outward, right? Fun fact, you can do spin. I'm going to do a little bit of spin here and just show you what that does first. It feels like a rotating propeller, which is kind of fun. Sometimes you use that in effects. You can redo it by just clicking up here. Whatever filter you did last is up at the top, which is pretty fun. Undo that. Motion blur is good for direction. So like side to side kind of thing, but that's not quite what I want either. So I want to do radial blur, but I want to select zoom instead. Thinking while working is hard. There we go. So that's about what I want. You can get even more fine-tuned with this. I'm going to use the grid to kind of show where that center of the radiation is from. You can do control apostrophe to show your grid. To get to your grid settings, yours might not be laid out like this. I'll just show you that real quick. Preferences. Whoop, whoop, I'm in the way. And then you go to guides, grids, and slices. And then grid line every 50%. Not pixels, not percent. Subdivisions too. I don't need to be off the side anymore. You can hit OK. And then your grid will look like this. And then control apostrophe on your keyboard will get you up and going. All right, so I think I want to change the center. Let's figure that out. Center was here. That's not quite the same center as there. Hit undo. Filter, blur, radial blur. You can do this really cool thing by clicking here. It'll change where the center's at. So I want my center to be a little off center, a little down. Hit OK, and that's just gonna get it a little nicer. The crazy thing about that is if you move that center around, it'll save the movement that you did. To reset that next time you go in here, because like maybe you did something over here and you want it back centered again and it's annoying, you can actually just hold control. Again, super not intuitive. I apologize for that, but that's why you have these videos. It changes cancel to default when you hold control. And then you click on that. It's a command on a Mac, I believe. And it'll just set it back to the same amount. It'll set it back to spin, but it puts it in center. So that's what you're after there, is getting that into center. All right, and then I can turn back on my effects. It feels nice and blurry there. Okay, So that's just one filter. There's lots of filters on here. Let's find out what else we can do with filters. We've got this fun thing called minimum and maximum. I don't know. Say you've got like, I'll use a different shape this time. Yeah, that's a good one. All right, so I got this here and I want to, you know how I expanded and contracted the selection a bit ago? Maybe what you want to do is expand and contract the fill. That's under filter other, maximum to make it skinny for some reason. And that's kind of fun how it does that. You see, it makes it like more like spindly and all that. And then maximum to make it bigger. Or minimum to make it bigger. You get the idea. Minimum, by the way, making it bigger, this is a very common technique. So I'll just show you what I'll do with this sometimes. I'll just come in here. I'll duplicate the layer. So to do that, you just drag the layer down to this create new layer. That's what I did there. And it'll just create a copy of it with all the same effects and everything. It's pretty handy. And then I can come in here and I can say filter minimum to make it bigger, right? So first you just make it burnt, like nice and big. Oh geez, what's happening with that blur? Something happened with the black. It normally doesn't happen. I don't know what's going on. Filter blur, and then I just like make that really fuzzy Gaussian blur, like so. And what it ends up doing is it ends up being like a glow that's a little more precise. So you're basically scaling it out and then fuzzing it out. So it feels like it's a cheap way to do glow around your stuff. So it'll feel like that, right? I don't know, try it out, tell me what you think. Okay, so trash that, because that does not work for what I want. Oops. If you click and it has the eyeball and then keep holding, it will like remove stuff. Or sorry, if it has the eyeball and you click and drag, it'll remove the eyeballs from all the others you drag over. If it has no eyeball, it'll make everything visible. Except I don't want that. Okay, I got my palette. Cool. I showed the palette, which I wanted to do anyway. Polar coordinates. This is a really fun one. So polar coordinates, always remember this. You want to paint from the North Pole. If you paint from the South Pole, well, I guess it depends on what you're doing. But typically with particles, you want like a burst to go outwards, not in. I'll show you what I mean. I'm going to create this bursty thing right here. Or something like it. I don't know, it's probably not going to look anything like it because I'm doing it on the spot. But with the brush tool, and remember we have the tilty brush. Why is the tilt not working? Pen tilt. I do too have pen tilt. Oh my goodness. I need to restart Photoshop. Remember I was talking in the last video about this? Okay, so I apologize. Give me a second. Restarting. Do. Yeah, we get the joys of the software acting up on us from time to time. And we're coming back in just a second. How are you guys doing today? You having a good day? I'm having a pretty good day. All right, and we're back. And now, this is gonna work, because I have a good feeling. Yep, sure enough, pen tilt works. My goodness, I gotta show that layer that I wanted. Down here is the palette layer. All right, so, hold Alt, grab, I'll grab that first. So I wanna paint from the top. Okay, we're gonna use a combination of a few different of these filters that I mentioned. Kind of get the squiggliness. Get it all nice and filled in. Cool. There's nice pointy points. All right. There we go. Hide that. Hold Alt and I can select another layer. I can just come in and just add some few hot streakies coming out. I can already tell this is going to be amazing, guys. This is going to be the best you ever did see. I just totally wiped out all the orange stuff that I just painted. Okay. And then this guy here. All right. And we'll do some like rays of white. Because why not? Why the heck not? And I want to hide all of these. So I clicked and dragged and it just kind of hid them all for me. And now I'm going to do some filter action. So first I'm going to do some blur. I'm going to do some motion blur. I don't want to blur it side to side as much as I want to blur up and down. So you can adjust this here to be like 90 or negative 90 degrees. Cool. And I want it to really, really like fuzz out for me. Oh, maybe not that much though. I want to keep the upper edge intact as much as I can, because that's going to be the center of my radiating burst. Cool. And then I can come in and I can do filter, and this is just going to be the best ever. I think polar coordinates used to be under other, but nowadays it's under distort. So polar coordinates, oh my gosh, it looks even better than I thought. You want to make sure you're doing rectangular to polar, not polar to rectangular. You can zoom out right here. Yeah, it's going to do something really weird if you do the other. Rectangular to polar, and you say okay. And now you've got the freaking coolest thing on the planet, which is this polar coordinates burst. So that's a commonly used technique. All right, so any other filters? I mean, I don't really know. Like, there's stuff that you can play around with under stylize, and I mean, this is fun. Offset for like tiling textures. You can like offset it by half of your scene width, and then it'll tile top to bottom or left to right if you paint it in. That's one that I use. You can use other types of blur, I guess, if you wanted to. But really, that's it. I mean, with the hand-painted style, we're not going to use a ton of filters. We don't want to use procedural techniques and maybe avoid them as much as possible. Oh, one other tip that I left out of the previous video with the brush tool, the brackets make it bigger and smaller. That's on your keyboard. That's next to the P key on an English keyboard. Big bracket, little bracket. You don't want to actually hit P like I just did. That's pretty common. Also on your tablet, sometimes there's a wheel or a bar that like slides. You can set that to make your brush big or small. I don't know if you probably knew that before, but if you didn't, there you go, free knowledge. Okay, guys, well, that should cover it for layers and selections on layers and filters. I hope you enjoyed it. Have fun playing around in Photoshop.